So how do we use all of these different calories, especially the ones for basal metabolic rate? You need to know where the majority of calories go to. So a quick graphic here to help us with that. First of all, our brain uses almost 20%. Again, we have numbers on here. You really need to consider the relativity. So which organ uses the most calories? Right? In our basal metabolic rate, we consider the liver, which may be surprising, but the liver uses the majority of our calories, but it does an awful lot of stuff. It's always active. It's always working for us, as well as our brain. So that also has a fairly high caloric usage. And then the heart is going to use about 7%. And the kidneys are pretty active in using calories. And then skeletal muscle. Well, of course, we're using the skeletal muscle to stand up and move around at all times. And so it is going to use, surprisingly, just about as much as the brain. So the brain really does have a high demand on our caloric intake. All the other organs fit into the other slice of the pie. So don't go memorizing the numbers. Understand the major users of our basal metabolic rate, the calories attributed to that. Brain, liver, skeletal muscle, heart, and kidney relative proportions are good enough because, again, sources will vary on the specific percentages. So any calories that we consume above and beyond our basal metabolic needs pictured here are going to be stored, right? And we generally will store them as fat, and they can become an issue if we have an imbalance in the intake and output of those calories. We need to consider for your exam what calories come from. You are familiar with the major macromolecules, carbohydrates, proteins, fats. Those are our sustenance. And then, of course, alcohol is an additional consideration for us when we're considering nutrition. You can see the USDA's recommendations of portion sizes. We moved from the pyramid to this full plate concept with all the different portions in various places. There are different arguments as to what are the ideal proportions of proteins, carbohydrates, and fats. But for the purposes of your exam, the standard here is probably going to be what they hit on most heavily. So keep these numbers in mind, four calories and four calories. Sometimes you'll see carbohydrates noted as 4.5. It seems for most sources, four is good enough. Alcohol, 7 calories per gram, and fat having the most calories per gram because it is an excellent calorie storage spot. So what you will also want to do is recall where each of the different fuels are utilized in cellular respiration or metabolism. And I'm certain that you've spent plenty of time examining those between anatomy and physiology, between cell and molecular biology, and in biochemistry for certain. You probably know many of the intermediates along the pathway, and what you need to remember in the senses of nutrition is where each of these sources enter into the respiratory cycle. So is it utilized in glycolysis? Is it utilized in the Krebs cycle? And where are the intermediaries coming into there? And again, that has been covered in the cellular respiration lectures. So keep those pathways in mind. The one that we may have not spent as much time in is alcohol metabolism. Alcohol metabolism is a particularly hot topic in the multidisciplinary area of nutrition for the exams. I think you've seen the pathway before. I want to alert you to the two key enzymes, alcohol dehydrogenase, which is involved in conversion of ethanol and some other alcohols to acetaldehyde, and then acetaldehyde dehydrogenase, taking more hydrogens off, and the formation of acetate, which can easily enter into the Krebs or TCA cycle so that it can be metabolized. Acetate is harmless. Acetaldehyde, on the other hand, is another story. It turns out to be fairly toxic. a couple of drugs to consider. There's Formepazole, and that is involved in treatment of alcohol poisoning, so ethylene glycol or methanol poisoning. It's administered to deactivate alcohol dehydrogenase and prevent poisoning from the buildup of acetaldehyde and other toxic chemicals. The next drug that you should be familiar with is disulfiram or antabuse. You probably heard that the symptoms of taking this drug and drinking alcohol are quite formidable in the sense of a really, really bad hangover. And that is because acetaldehyde dehydrogenase is inactivated, and that results in a buildup of acetaldehyde. And excessive acetaldehyde is what causes the classic symptoms of a hangover. So usually the hangover results from having sort of a backlog in the activity of these enzymes. So we have a buildup of the intermediaries creating a hangover. Antabuse blocks that, creating greater symptoms and ideally prohibiting the individual from wanting to consume alcohol because it feels so awful. Anyway, that's what you need to know on the basics of alcohol metabolism as far as nutrition is concerned.